A warm welcome from my side. Thank you very much for coming to the How 3 top floor. That's the first session for us this year here in the How 3, and I just mentioned it to the technicians. Whenever I see this house full of people, I think now talents really has started. We had already How 1, we had already How 2. We have all the 250 talents in town. Many of them are here, I guess. But it's always so nice to see you actually here all summed up all together in the stage, which is probably the most interactive one, because we can actually see you. That's very good, also from here. And also, we have always quite, I would say, interactive sessions, good exchange. And the film we are talking today about, this is definitely not a secret, is a film you might have all seen already. So, Blade Runner 2049. I've seen it a while ago, and I was amazed. Hopefully, you also liked it. But on the other side, I think there's a lot of secrets behind the film and in the making. And this is also what Talents is about, for those who don't know us so well. So we have all the different disciplines here, and also including the cinematographers, the people working on lighting, the people doing production design, and all these different ways and different angles to look on film. This is what Berlinale Talents is about, and in that sense it feels very natural. And it's not a secret for me to share with you. I'm very happy to have these people here today with us to share insights into an amazing production. We're doing it together with a bunch of fantastic people around, also from the team, but also from our partner Ari. I'm very happy to have them. I think they know many secrets already, but they are still here, and they are also happy to share a little bit more of that later on. Thank you very much, Ari, for making it possible. And without any further ado, I will leave the floor to this gentleman, and especially also to the moderator, Andrew Amondson. Thank you.
Thank you, Florian. So welcome, welcome. I'm happy to be here today to introduce you to two artists and technicians. And I think those two things are important to think about, that the artistry and the ability to use the techniques to bring out the artistry. So we're very fortunate to have them here. Titusz Badonics is the light board operator from 2049. He's done a number of films, Atomic Blonde as well, and some big productions. And the gaffer from the film, we have Krisztián Paluch.
Welcome, everybody.
Welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning. And there's too many films to list, but you've done over 30 different series and big productions, a lot of them coming through Budapest, where you're located, right?
Yeah, we did a couple of big things and smaller things, and we are still working in smaller projects and bigger ones. So we are not shooting only big pictures like The Bedrair or The Martian or The Inferno. We are still doing small TV series as well.
Right, The Martian was also filmed there. That's for everyone here, I think it does work really well if we keep it open throughout, and it's also been the wish from Krisztián and Titus here, that if questions come out throughout, please feel free to jump in with them, and I think their presentation today will spark a lot of questions. Just to get a sense of who's in the audience, could get a show of hands from some of the different fields in the film. How many cinematographers do we have here? Okay, great.
A lot, so we have to watch what are we telling.
Yeah. And directors? Great. Designers? Okay. And lighting technicians? Great. Very good. Okay, you came to the right place. So we'll get started, and I wanted to ask you we want to jump into Blade Runner 2049 because it's such an amazing piece of work that you've helped create. Can you talk about when you first found out that this film was coming to town and that you were going to be working on it, your first feelings, your first thoughts?
If I remember well, the first time when I hear that the Blade Runner is going to come to Hungary, I was in the Inferno with Ron Howard and DOP Salvatore Tutino. And just the Hungarian producer mentioned to me that Blade Runner is coming with Roger Deakins. And they are going to introduce me to him. So I was just wow, who had a good chance to work with a famous DP like him. And then I heard rumors that Roger already tried to find some other DPs who I work with, like Darius Wolski in The Martian, and he also had a good contact with Salvatore Tortino, so he checked me through those guys, and they all both recommend me to work with him because they were satisfied with my team and with me.
I'd read that Bill O'Reilly, who was Roger Deakins' longtime gaffer, talked about, you know, apart from his own crew in New York, that that you guys were the best that he's worked with. So I think you must have done something right.
Yeah, it was good to
hear
that.
A big compliment, yes.
That's such an amazing honor to work with somebody, a master like Roger Deakins, I'd imagine. So what were the first conversations like when you first did meet? How did he relay to you what the vision was for the film, both the one that he and Denis created?
I met with him in the first time in 2017, February. I just ran out from the studio to meet with him. I had only a couple of minutes because I shoot it, the Inferno reshoot in that time. And I just saw a very nice old man in the distance. I went to him. I don't know who was the one, but maybe the production manager just introduced me to him. And you know, I just even forgot my name. I just humble, same like now. So, oh, wow, a living God in front of me. You know, I think that's the dream of all the gaffers, to work a DP like him. He's a legend, I think, between us. In that time, he couldn't tell me a lot of things because he said that he's at the beginning of the prep. He still has a lot of things, different ideas. But he warned me that this guy gonna be a massive one. So we will have to be prepared.
And how did you prepare?
We didn't sleep a lot. before I was involved to the shooting, or you know, just the production hired me, I couldn't do anything. I just waited for information from Roger, and then when they hired me, when I met with him at the first time, he already had a booklet of the movie, which was like this big, you know, in white, with lighting plans, with reference photos, set drawings, jail list, what kind of colors does Ivana use, where exactly. But that was only a basic ideas, so we went through all the set. He was open for ideas. But you know, what can I say to a DP who is in the film industry since like almost 50 years? So he already shooted movies when I even didn't were born.
Before you were born, yeah.
Yeah. I think that was it.
Well, I know you've both created a presentation for us to share, and I think that this, from what I know, you're touching on these early phases. So, Titus, you want to take that?
Yeah, I can say a bit.
Yeah.
If you can switch. Okay. So, before they came to Hungary, they were planning this mood and ambience in Montreal, as I heard, for several weeks, which we didn't know too much about.
And who's this?
You don't know her? It's I wanted to turn back time a bit of 2049, go back to 2018. There were 12 camels disqualified in Saudi Arabia from the Miss Camel beauty contest. And you know what was the problem? They cheated and they created an illusion with Botox injections. And that's what we do pretty much, creating illusions. But let's get back to Mr. Deakins. And so they were planning this thing. I didn't know, at this stage, I didn't know anything about it. Krisztián told me that there will be this film. It would be good if we could work together, but I had no idea how big it's gonna be or who I'm gonna work with, how it's gonna happen, pretty much. And then they came to Hungary. Probably, you know, they chose Hungary because of maybe good crew, as Bill O'Reilly said, and studio time is significantly cheaper, I think. Some taxation discounts, the government gives you taxation discounts on films. And then we started to experiment with these small lighting set, building Roger's fantasies and ideas, but in a small scale.
This was the first time that I worked with Titus, so I just wanted to test him as well, not only the lights, but him as well.
How did I succeed?
So you had to, you had to, once you found out you were on this film, you had to put together your team. Yeah. And what who did your team consist of? So you have a lighting board operator, who else is, how many people do you have on your crew, and how does that, how do you manage that?
I think we have to go back in time a little bit. That's a bit longer story. When a big blockbusters like this are coming to Hungary to shoot, the DOP always bringing his gaffer. In good, mostly they are working together since a long time, and that's good because they know each other, you know, communication is much more fluently between them, like with a new person. And Roger also brought Bill O'Reilly with him to his shoot, who was great. I have never ever worked with an experienced gaffer like him. And we started to do a discussion with the producers, three of us together, where Roger warned everybody that this is a big project, everybody has to be clear with it, that we will have to have a lot of works. Sometimes we had to light three studios with big sets in the same time, and all together in the shows, I think, if I remember well, we had like 15 or 16 studios full with sets, plus backlots as well. So that was a huge work. I think it was the biggest in my life. So we should decide that, okay, usually we are working, I'm working with one rigging gaffer, but for this amount of work, one rigging gaffer is not gonna be enough. And we couldn't find anybody in Hungary who was able to do this job. So B said that he would like to bring somebody into the production from the States, who was Richie Ford, an old rigging gaffer. He was over 60, but also very experienced, very calm. He had very good ideas to do something easier or to do something, some tricky things. So we should call a couple more guys. And also because in Hungary we are shooting with the English way of the shoot. So the grip department is doing only camera grips, and not like in the States that the grip department is doing lighting grips, so they are handling the frames, the flags, and all these things. So I have to have a bigger crew, like, I think I had like 12 or 14 people on the shoot, including the board operator all the time. Plus the rigging crew, which was like also 12, 10, 20 people. So we had a big crew.
Great. Can we see some more of the
Sure, sure. Let me just show you some piece of this construction and testing part. The production had to build an outside tank for the ocean beach shot where the fighting happened. It was a huge construction, and it had to be done when we get there to shoot the scene. So timing was really, really key. And it's a huge mashup of engineering. Here you can see the slides where big splashes of water hit the transporters and spinners, and the fighting scene was here. You see these eight containers for water. There's a rain machine. They used excavators with huge barrels attached to the arm, and it was moving the water, creating the waves. Here you can see the camera platform, A and B. So it's quite a big, heavy machinery, and it was full of water. But when we got there to shoot, it was quite cold, like winterish time, around 0 Celsius, and sometimes we had ice. The water was warm for the actors and the divers, so we always had a constant steam and fog. So quite a desirable effect. It's a foggy film, so this fog was actually really handy by itself. It's quite an interesting
mashup. For such a big setup, what was the lighting setup for this? How was the lighting worked out for this scene?
I think everybody thinks that we had a night scene here, so everybody thinks that we had a massive lighting setup here. And at the beginning, we wanted to use big butterflies with magnitudes and a lot of lights from the top of the dam to have some nice moonlight. But when we could see the spinners, these cars, we could see that because of all of these curves and a lot of glass surfaces, everything could reflect it in the windows. So I think Roger made a very brave decision to not use anything, only the lights of the spinner and the practical lights are inside the car.
So he used the practical lights from the cars,
yes,
to light the scene without.
We are reinforcing a little bit the headlights of case spinners and the tail lights too, but that was all what we did in that set.
I mean, it's so interesting. We were talking earlier about this idea that maybe a less experienced DP might feel the need for this night scene to have the moon bright and see everything in the shot, but this, just to work with the DP like Roger, who's making bold decisions like this. Can you talk about that?
I wouldn't say that this is a poor decision. So, but he's so experienced that he could know that what can you do with the camera. He knows what he wanna see in the movie exactly. So, he didn't want it to play, I think, with the stocking in grading.
So a lot of his work was really in camera?
Yeah.
Okay. Back in the studio, we started to build these small lighting sets. This was one of Roger's obsession, this chasing circular setup. Here we use around 30 lamps and experiencing, how it looks on the face, making a bigger circle, more lamps, how we're gonna go with the final rig. And this is the earlier stage of the many hundred RE 300 chase, which I'm going to show a bit later on.
And the desired effect from this chasing, what is that doing in the scene for?
Actually, you will see, but it gives you a nice wash and it goes around the head. It's a pretty interesting effect. I'm going to show the actual shot a bit later on.
So you're starting to test, all these ideas that are coming in from Roger.
Yeah. So not like this, but we had some like 10 different set pieces to set, like a tank, a small tank with reflection of the water on the wall, like space light with different kind of chairs, a filter test with pure tungsten lights, So I think we spent like a week to test different lighting setups.
With the microphone in play here.
Can you ask that question
one more time?
I'm curious. Of course, awesome to test the stuff on a smaller scale, but who came up with the test designs? Was it like you guys in common, or was Roger suggesting it to test it like with 30 smaller lights, or who was that?
It was mainly Roger. He wanted to see that his idea gonna work, or what should he change into them. But some of them we also wanted to test that. Are we going to be able to do that, what he wanna do, what he wanna get or not? And also the test of Titus.
Yeah, also he was open to test different kind of lamps, so it wasn't that strict what we have to use, but let's try this, let's try that. Maybe we're never gonna use that, but see how it, you know, what kind of light we can play with it. So, yeah, he was open for ideas.
Yeah, we tested like 3 or 4 different type of light to have the right reflection from the water to the wall, that you can see in the Velas office set. Yeah. We tested intelligent lights, like big bees,
bad boys,
some tungsten lights without Fresnels, tungsten light with full spot or full flat position.
Everything, we tested everything. Okay, let's move on if this computer wants it. Come on. Okay, so here, to see the sets, you know, the miniature department and the art department, they provided this kind of small paper modeling, which is really handy if you wanna scale your lighting, or in this case, a banana. it was a really handy thing. It's about a BB's bar set, which you will see a complete shot later on. And it, you know, it shows that many people works in the background. Some of them you don't even meet. You don't see these people just get something like this put on a table and, okay, who made this amazing thing? So you feel like the whole team is really enthusiastic about to make this film happen. And that was a really good feeling to be a part of this kind of team.
These models are very handy for a lot of departments, mainly for us as well, because you can see the measurements, you can see the wall of the studio, you can see that how much space do I have to put lights here, there, where can I have any problem with flags or something or teasers, so you can see your possibilities more than on a 2D drawing.
Here's a concept art, just for an interesting effect. It's a really noirish picture, but you know, you were provided with ideas like this. Okay, this is something how I wanna see the final shot, and just triggers your mind and creativity if you see something like this. This is an actual shot.
Didn't happen.
Over here you see the background of Los Angeles. We can cut the video, the audio. The background of Los Angeles was a paper cut, cardboard thingy. Really, when I was standing next to it, you know, it was here, a house with LED sticks. It looked cheesy, like, sorry to say, but what is this thing? But when you went to the camera, when you went up there through this rainy window, it just snapped to place, like, wow, it really looks like greater Los Angeles. We also used LED sticks and small lights, some Christmas lights, which was provided by famous Swedish lighting company. Anybody knows? IKEA, yeah, that's right.
And this is interesting because a lot of times this would just be green screen, right?
Yes, in this movie we couldn't use so many green screen. I would say that maybe only like two times, but not more. So we had like these maquettes in the background in this set and in case rooftop set and some others one. So we have to make life with small lights or so small lighting effect into them. Like the audience should feel that this is a living city.
And how about the movement of lights? I mean, not in this shot, but for the living aspect of this, because there's so many things happening in this film. The idea that lights are moving, that there's mm-hmm. this, that as a character, the lighting as a character in the city.
Yeah, I think the lighting is the third actor or some second, third actor. You know, if you see two persons standing statically in a shot or just really slow movement, but the lighting is really dynamic in the background. Yeah, it really gives you a feeling of motion and tension and whatever Deakins wants just to feel, you will feel that.
You can see a couple of moving lights in this set as well on other pictures or some other sets too, where we had big bees on the top, sometimes on cranes, sometimes on trusses in fixed points, and sometimes we had to use those lights like a follow spot, which is really, really hard actually with a bad boy, which is, you know, you have to programming, you have to give him points to move from here to there, then to here, and with this speed or that speed. Plus if you are moving those lights with a techno crane, then two or three other people will be involved into that process, so that makes it quite a hard thing, I would say. And this was one of the first set, and this is the second, this case apartment. For example, this is the place where we had the light on the crane, where we had the movement with the head, and then they start to pull the techno crane and the light with it. We had exact cue when should everything happen in that scene. So we spend a couple of hours to practice these things on the pre-light days.
Okay, I'd like to show you some a little bit bigger subject, getting back to exact lighting plots and planning really how it's gonna look.
So this is what we're looking at is?
Yes, these are hand-drawn by Deakins himself. And when we got, you know, in the beginning of production, he said he wants this hollow fun house, look like an old deserted casino with a stage, with Elvis, with things are happening crazily. And he drawn these plots by himself, you know, filled with pencil and stuff. It's really crazy. He uses everything to communicate with you, to get his vision, his ideas. He uses everything, even this, or just, you know, pushing the message. And these are, I think these are really great examples of those. We have these steps. First, he wanted a classical look, like a classical gala style lighting. And then it just starts to evolve and starts to glitch and lasers coming and elephants and that was a funny part.
Now, no quick question there, because I was wondering, you know, not having read the script, you know, are the elephants in the script, or is this a, you know, imagination of Deakins' imagination. Like, it's as a lighting this comes in with everything.
Or is some elements was in the script that Elvis is showing up, dancers are showing up, some address holograms will show up in the set, but the lighting, the idea of the lighting is coming from Roger.
Okay, so to make this, To make this easy to find time to design these sets, we set up a previous studio on Origo Studios area with a lighting board, a computer, so we could plan ahead our scenes, effects, whatever Roger wanted, you know, we can present on a computer right then. It was really helpful, so we found an extra 2-3 hours after shooting, after testing, or in the morning. It really helped a lot, and it was growing and growing and growing. You know, he was asking, like, how many lamps we are using already? 100. Okay, I could use a bit more. Like, 110? Just double it up, you know. Okay. And it started to look prettier and prettier. Also, we get some videos from VFX team. They designed one kind of take, how it's gonna look, which I'm going to show you. It has audio of, yeah. It looks a bit cheesy, but at least you get an idea. I got an idea what's gonna happen.
We could see this music like hundreds or 200s of times. We love it.
Kill me.
In here you can also see that we had a storyboard for all over the scene, so Denis and Roger spent like I think more than 2 weeks to make a book with full of storyboard pictures. The book was like something like this, an A4 paper. So they knew exactly what they wanna shoot. They were so well prepared on the shooting that, you know, they didn't have to spend time to figure out the shot or just standing there and, you know, just thinking, oh, okay, what's gonna be the next, because they did it already in the prep.
Can you talk about your the work and reminder, just at any point, if something triggers you and you wanna ask a question, do jump in, pass the box around. So your role as the light board operator, and when you have, so this is an intensive scene for you.
Yes, yeah. Actually, this was quite a teamwork. I didn't program this. I was mostly helping to communicate between the Hungarian outsider board operator and Deakins, which is always really recharging. Whenever I spoke to Mr. Deakins, just electrifies, really. But this is quite a heavy set, because when you get there, you have to be, you know, exact. We put it on time code, everything, but of course, things are not going always as planned, so you have to change. Oh,
they are never going like you planned.
That's the right one.
Actually, so yeah. Personally, I thought that this was in the middle of the shooting, so I think around the second month of the shoot or the third month, and I thought that maybe I will have like 3 days when I can lie down on a couch or something, and I can watch them to work, because this was mainly for the existing lights. Roger wanted to have a very natural look on this set as well, and same as all over the movie. So when we had these lights, we didn't use any more additional lights, maybe some polyboards or some small bounces on the shoot. But the board operators did the majority of the works here. And as the beginning on the pre-light, we thought that if we are doing this show for a barcode, that could work, and it will be easy, because they are going to tell us that, okay, I want to use the show from the 10 seconds or from the 20 seconds, and then you can go on. But in every picture, you had to change the setup. And sometimes, unfortunately, the board operators are using different boards and they are not speaking in the same language. So the chain of the communication was very long, and sometimes the information lost in the chain of the communication. So I just had to figure out an easier and a faster way to give the information for the programmer from Roger. Yeah,
that was a tough times. Actually, what was tough for a second unit, because they had to reshoot this same scene. You know, they recorded the holograms and whatnots, Elvis and the piano and Marilyn and all those extra things. So they had to do the exact same shots what Deakins used. They had to place the camera on the same spot. They had to use the same motion, the same zoom, everything. They had to copy from an existing shot, and no motion control, no computer, nothing, handwork. So that was quite a challenge for them, I'm sure.
Yeah. If we can move into a bit of the color is such an important part of this film. Can you talk about, I had read somewhere that, you know, I don't know how many thousand rolls of gel were used, but, you know, what are these choices? What are the, can you talk about how color was talked about from Roger's point of view?
Ooh. The colors was really important in the Odo LA sets. Like in the casino, and you can see on these pictures, in the desert or in LA, where Roger used a special filter in the camera, so we didn't have to JS all the lights in here, because in here everything can be, you know, paint by the filter, so the skin tones and these things wasn't so important. But when we shooted the interiors of this set, we had to use chairs on the set itself, so not on the camera, because we had the faces, and he didn't want it to use the camera theater in the camera. So yeah, for the interior part of this set, we had to use like 250 rows of golden amber chairs on the windows. So, you know, the building was similar to a Christmas package or something, if you are looking it outside. And all the other set was, all the other set had a kind of a chair list that what kind of colors Roger van use for the specific sets. Mostly just reflecting how can I say, the commercial boards or these advertising lights or something, or the lights of the city itself.
Can we go deeper in this set a bit? Yes, the lighting please. Of this this scene, because we used quite a lot of lights. I think it was a 264 space lights, which itself quite a big number, and some dinos. And we really had to know how it works. You know, rigging department built it for us, and I had to know what can go wrong, because it will go wrong. And if it goes wrong, you just lose time, which I don't want to lose time with Roger Deakins. No, he can go crazy with that. So I used this set as a big screen, these many, many space lights. So I could play videos on it, which looks a bit weird, but now I am in control of all the lights. I can put a gradient screen on it. So if there's a request, okay, I want the lamps fade from this corner to that corner, I can easily do that with fast and the flexible. And with some fog and those special filters on the camera, it really gave us a great result. Sorry. As you can see in the final.
Roger wanted to do this movie he wanted to give this movie to a very natural look. So everything is reflecting that when you are in a sandstorm in the desert, the lights could be something like this. So he wanted to replicate all the time the natural lights in the set.
Yeah. Well, this was, you know, we built this the very last time, because it was always okay, I need 10 more, just a bit more there, could we add a bit more over there and over there. So it was constantly growing, but when you get there, you just have to shoot it. Okay, let's move on to the Wallace office. As probably you know, the Wallace was blind. So
good question.
I just wanted to ask whether everything was rendered in that scene, or did you have any props, like where the ladies?
It's all real. What we are showing you here, it's all real.
Okay.
It's no render, no green screen.
Okay, so you had like the in between. You just had the lights, and below you have a studio with all the props, and then you okay.
Yeah.
And the color? How did you manage to? You used colored lights or what?
The color, he put a little filter in front of the camera.
Okay.
That's a lot cheaper solution than color all the lights.
Can I ask a question as well? When you're doing these lighting effects and doing this programming, do you have like a pre-light days where you would test it and then program all the cues, or is this done directly when you're shooting? Or?
Fortunately, I do have some pre-lighting time creating effects, but you have to be really flexible to change everything in a second on the fly. You cannot be sure that this is going to be fixed and we're going to change that or the otherwise. But I got some preparation time, so I'm lucky.
Yeah, we had like three board operators in this show. We had an English fan, Stephen Matty, who did a couple of big pictures as well. So he had also a very good experience about these things. And yeah, we had pre-light days for every set. Yeah, we didn't shoot any sets without the pre-lights. So we had to check everything, we had to prepare for everything again, and we tried to give every flexibility to Roger what we could do. So
I got a great example to that.
I'm just gonna go back to the Las Vegas set a little bit.
Sure.
So if you can see that there is like 300 lights, it could be easy to put everything for one slider, and you know, you can just pull it down or pull it up, you can make more lights or less lights, but then you cannot give any flexibility for the DP, and I think that's not the way. So in here everything has to be on separate channels, and even, you know, not only the lights, but you know, the space lights has six bulb, or the individual bulb has to be in different channels, which is a big work to put it on the board. But as soon as you are ready with it, you can do everything what you want. And we did, actually. So yeah. It wasn't like that, okay, we have the big soft source from the top and we are done. Because every picture, you know, when we change the camera position, we always change the lights a bit, so darker behind the camera, and we made some kind of gradations, you know, some more light in the middle and less light towards the edge of the frame, or to give some kind of soft direction, so you to use more light from the right side and a bit less from the left. That's it, actually.
Okay.
Thank you.
So how do you light up a blind man's apartment? Any way you want. That's where Roger went havoc, you know. He used his ideas. He let his mind wander, play with reflections, shadows. That's where we used different kind of lamps, which works best with this reflection. And
this was one of the most important set for him. So when he was over of this set, he became very relaxed. He started to making jokes, and you know, you could see the change of his mood on the shoot.
When we create
this mothership that's hanging above.
Yeah.
That's from the Independent Day.
Yeah, big UFO. And when you build this, the set is dry. You know, there's no water in it. You build it. And as Krisztián told me, they painted the bottom black and put some dye in the water, so it gives you a different kind of reflection, just as Roger wanted. But when you use the effect, it's full of water. So if you need to change something, you put the machinery in water, and you know, it's not that easy anymore just to go there with a ladder and change the lamps. And yeah, this is his famous chase. That's how it started, easy, you know, the 30 lamp setup. I want a chase, easy peasy, lemon squeezy. And okay, I want two. Okay, in the opposite direction. Yeah, no problem. Yeah, but it has to be faster and slower, and this grows when it moves forward, and it bounces back, then just dims down a bit, and the other one just kills. Okay, that's difficult. So you have to be really flexible, changing everything. This was a quite smart bitmap work by Stephen Matty. He did this part. He's quite a smart guy. And here you can see the effect. I think it's really stunning. Maybe the only CGI is to take off the rig, and all the rest is real.
But we could, in here we could see the question from Roger that is it going to be work? Is it going to be good? So he was a bit uncertain himself as well. He had the basic ideas what he wanna see, but when we were ready with the rigs and we started to test all these kind of chasing or all the reflections of the water, he came up some new ideas, which was small, just to say that okay, we should make another kind of grid cloth or something under the rigs. But it was a big change, you know, in the rigs itself. So if he wanted to change something, it means for us that it was like 2 days of re-rigging.
We got some video problems, I think.
The question was, how long did you have to pre-light that?
I think, if I remember well, I wanted to be ready with that set like 2 weeks before the day of the shoot. Just to give time to the rigging crew as well, and for Roger to see that if they want to change something, then we should have enough time to change it. And the thing that we had water in the tank that didn't make our life easier, but you know, you couldn't see the effect if you don't have the water. So it was hard, yeah. We had like 2 weeks, and then we had 1 day of pre-lighting, and then on the next week we had another one, and just before the shoot we had another day, that just to check everything.
Great, we have another question in the back left corner. You can toss it back up there. Nice catch.
What did actually cost the reflection of the water on the walls?
They were 12K tungstens. Eventually with Fresnels, and that's all. So normal tungsten lights. From the truss, I think there is a picture. If I can, where we can see.
Which one? This one?
No. There is a. I think yes.
Yeah, there are some. This huge black skirt.
Yes, you can see the part of the lights just behind the ring. They are there. The tank case. All of them were on max movers, so we was able to move them without bringing a machine. But to find the right distance between the wall and the water, the height and everything. That wasn't like a minute of work, so we spent a couple of hours to find the right spot with them.
Yeah, and then we fortunate. Is there any more questions?
I think there's one over here, but you can talk as they pass
okay.
The microphone
so
over.
So fortunately, after these many hundred lamps, we moved to, you know, small few units, few bigger lamps, and Roger started to create these psychedelic looks. Using water and aquariums on the top of the set. Like here was some kind of aquarium, a few big units lit from above. And fortunately, there was no real programming involved, so I had some resting time. Enjoy these psychedelic looks. Probably the 60s and the 70s were quite a big impact.
And this was my most relaxed days, actually, because I...
Your most exhausting days?
No, the best day for me, because I didn't have any board operator next to me, so I was free from them.
Yeah, well, these are hand jobs actually, and just look how great a first stair walk is this.
How was this achieved? This is such a great mixture of like the architecture of the sets. How was this planned into, you know, what lights did you use for this and to create this effect?
This was quite easy. We had only three bare bulbs on the top of the set on a rope field. Everything was independent from each other. Richie Ford and Patrick, his friend, just figured out the rope here, rope field. They tested and they did all the sockets for the lights. We never done that before, just removing bare bulbs on ropes. So, you know, because of the heat, it was some problem. We have to watch the safety as well. What will happen if a bulb will blow up or something like that?
It really expands the space, doesn't it? And
yeah. Whoa. But this set was towards the end of the shooting, and I would say that, you know, if I can see what did we do, we didn't spend so many time with figured out the lighting of this set. It was just a fast idea from Roger. Okay, what if we are taking something hard, some kind of hard lights, hard sources to the top, and then we're gonna play with that, and that was that. And actually, like three ring gaffer spent like 2 weeks or something to figure out that how can we rig up these things to the top as Roger wanted, and how can we get that effect what he dreamed.
The question up there?
Yeah, hi. I had a question about color. I was wondering how were different grades, since it was mostly tungsten lights, how were different grades of yellow, orange achieved? An example, the desert has a warm orange look and the Wallace house is more towards cool yellow, teal sort of tint. Was it achieved with gels? Was it achieved with filtration on camera? Was it in post? What was how was this decision made?
It was, we did it mostly with lights and gels. I think that was the only one place where Roger used the color filter in the camera, that was the Las Vegas interior set. All the rest is, you know, what you can see. So it was pure tungsten light or pure HMI lights with some special kind of chairs.
Okay, thank you.
Here is a little shadow game. You know, shadows are free. That's a bad news for Ari. you know, using opposition, that's an interesting effect as these stripes are moving on the actors. And Roger really has an extraordinary talent to shrink or expand the space with his luminaire lights, you know, plays. Really interesting, and it's so good to watch him, you know, playing with this thing, like you know, like a childish soul, to be honest. Like,
I have to say that we lighted the future with a very old style of lights. So, for example, in here we had like two pieces of 20K sky pens, but Ari couldn't find in Europe, so we had to have them from the States.
Was there much mixing between? I mean, so you have. I mean, it's an interesting idea that for the future you're using these old lights. I mean, but also the Blade Runner idea is that the future is a little bit run down. So you had sky panels available to you. You had all the other, but mostly you were working with tungsten. Did you mix them at all?
I think we had only one set where we could use the sky panels in this one. In the next one, you can see. And at the beginning, I had a couple of ideas, like in a police corridor or something, to use LEDs. But Roger, I think Roger is an old gaffer, so he was satisfied with all kind of tungsten light. He knows them. He knew what can he do with those lights, and maybe he wanted to spare some money for something else. You know, like a 300 tungsten light is much more cheaper than a sky panel or a small LED or something like that.
I think when he wanted to go a real futuristic feel, that's when we use sky panels. On this set, it was 100 piece of sky panels, which for me, it's really good. Featureful lamps, you know, programming wise, it's a really smart lamp. I can tweak it, I can play with it.
Right.
Of course, a tungsten lamp is a lot more simple, but from another point of view, that works better for simple tasks or different tasks. For me, sky panels works better for what I want to use it for.
I had thoughts that maybe sometimes where we had one case on the bottom of the set, we did for different kind of chairs. Instead of those, we could use like L7Cs or L10Cs, because for those you cannot have chairs and you can change the colors, you know, with the full range. So if Roger thinks that maybe he preferred the yellow rather than the green, then we can change it very easily. But he preferred the tungsten light with gel, so we couldn't go for this futuristic way of lighting, unfortunately or fortunately. But on another hand, it made our life easier because an old tungsten light is not so sensitive like a new style of these L series or something. And we continuously had water in the set. We had water sprays, all kind of watery atmosphere. And I personally couldn't test any L series lights in this environment. So maybe it could cause some kind of problem. So, but we went with the old style of tungsten lights.
Also, it was really strange that we started to shoot in springtime and we went all the way through winter, early winter. But in the studio, you know, we played that it's winter, and when it was spring outside, it's winter, but it's not cold. But you feel like, okay, it's snow here. I pick up my jacket. Okay, I'm warm. I go outside. It's spring. You go crazy, really. Like, you go inside the studio, 35 degrees, 100% humidity. You get out, 60 degrees, 16 degrees. You know, nice breeze. Like, where am I actually? Really, really go crazy. Okay, let's move on to
questions.
Another.
Yeah, moving on, but yeah.
Okay, let's move on to another set. I think that's the romantic part of the film between a hologram and a replicant. So that's already, you know, the human emotions are in between a hologram and a replicant, so okay. But as I told you, it's like the third actor is lighting. You know, dynamic lighting are in the background. That's what's creating movement and tension in a set, and the camera movements are really smooth, really slow, really artistic. The actors are playing just small sensual parts. I think that's a great look of a romantic cut. It's kind of a melancholic, slow-paced feeling. You can see a little red flash when it just loops. We used these color blast LED long strips to create a sense of or illusion of spaceships or cars, flying cars are moving. So we really did quite a lot of illusions with lighting. Maybe it's just a hue and ambience, but you feel like, okay, there's something happening. Or you are just a part of a huge universe on a small rooftop, but you feel the universe is out there because of lighting gives you that feeling. And, yeah, go on.
Hi. I have a question. Can you talk a bit about haze and fog, and if you use different hazers or fogs? Because now seeing this setup and seeing the desert looked much different to me. Do you use different styles?
Yeah, that was the only set where we used haze. All the rest of the set was this kind of water spray instead of haze or smoke or anything, because you cannot control the smoke so precisely like the water. So after a while, you know, the smoke is going everywhere into the set.
So you use a fine water mist for the desert?
No, not for the desert, but all the rest of the sets.
Oh, the rest of the sets, yeah. Okay, yeah.
The desert was the only one where we had haze.
Okay.
Yeah, the special effect team was providing us everything, rain, fog, haze. You know, you just don't know what you expect when you go to work. Okay, it's raining, there's a curtain, I don't see anything, it's fog. Okay, let's do this. It's really, really funny.
One question I had is just, in your experience working with Roger Deakins, can you say what makes the difference with an experienced DP like him and maybe another DP who doesn't have the same experience? What's important when a DP is trying to communicate his vision to you? For the DPs that are in this audience and they're working with their gaffer, what's the best way for them to relate their vision to you?
Roger is a one-man army, I would say.
Roger's a what?
Roger is like a one-man army, so he's doing everything. He's like a first AD, a visual supervisor, a kind of director of first AD. So he likes to keep everything in his hand. He's not using camera operator. He's still operating the camera himself. And you know, he's so experienced that usually he's just telling you that, okay, I'm gonna have this and this and that, which makes your life easier sometimes, or harder in other times. And he knew exactly what he can do with the camera, so he don't want to overlight the set. He knows that, okay, I'm gonna keep that corner dark, I don't need any details in that, and he is going to keep that corner dark because, you know, he's not thinking, I think so, maybe I'm not right, but he's not thinking to the gridding that, okay, if that corner is not too dark, I will just pull down towards the black.
Can we get back to a really old school effect, one of my favorites? Okay, not this one.
Am I answering your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
So here, of course, we have rain. We use a small lamp on a rubber rope, like shooting as a slingshot. So Roger can record the reaction of the actors, you know, like following the light. And so the reaction is real. And CGI later on takes the light lamp. It's going to be a rocket or a spinner or whatever. And the explosion here is also just a tungsten light. With a shutter. It's a really old school effect, but over there it works perfectly, you know, and then you just touch it up.
It's a way to, helping the performers, the actors in the space to, it seems like also with this Christmas light lit background city, just giving them something real to work with.
Yeah, that's when, what's important is that he can cue, this thing just fell apart again. He can cue the lighting sequences. I can program the sequence and give the triggering to Chris or Roger. So to synchronize actor movements, he just starts, okay, I need it a bit longer, and you can go up to him. That's why we use the remote control, remote mechanism. So I could go up to him and get his ideas, his visions, tell me what do you want, and until it's not right, we're gonna correct it. Great.
And do you have more there?
Yeah, just that's how that you mentioned that. How did we communicate his visions? I went behind the monitor and okay, change this, change that. But it's really, it was like, until it's not right, mm-hmm. it doesn't let you go. You know, like, you have to be right.
Yeah, sometimes we had to wait for the right lighting effect like 2 hours, and he said, okay, I can wait, I can go to drink a tea or something, and you can work. He never was nervous or something because of the time, so he always gave you enough time to do it. And actually, he said, if we will have to come back tomorrow to have the right lights, then we're going to come back tomorrow. And but then the producer came down first from the offices, so... So as soon as something's happened in the set, I could see that one or two of the producers came already down to check the things. And
I was going to ask, just because, you know, also in this theme of lighting the future, with all these new technologies coming out with lighting that enhance what the cameras are now able to do, and we also have head of the product management from Ari here as well, in case we get into this technical questions of what's coming that you're looking forward to with lights, with the programmability of these lights. Where do you see it going?
I think everything is going towards the LEDs, is it? Am I right? But still, you know, you can do the same effect with all type of lights as well. But sometimes it's much more faster, much more easier to work with the small, with the new LED stuff. And makes the shooting way more faster than before. The sky panel is a great product, I think. That's a very good invention from the area. I think that is the most popular light nowadays. Everybody wants to use that. I'm curious that the LED spots gonna go forward, or what will happen with them.
Is there anything you want to say of what's coming? Any sneak peeks into the future of what lighting is in store? Okay. Okay, the old ladies come in other shows. Good. You're keeping it a secret for right now. Well, you can ask them some secrets out in the lobby. Any more questions before we have about 10 more minutes? Yes?
Did you stay in the scheduled time budget? I mean, did you like spend exactly the amount of days you had for, or if not, how much were you overdue?
Did you stay within the time frame and the budget that you had for this film?
I'm not so much interested in the financial aspect. It's really about time. Like, did you like, you know, you schedule so and so many days for each scene, and in the end, like, did you manage to stay in the time that was scheduled, or if not, how much overdue were you?
I think we had like 10 extra days of shooting, we couldn't finish the movie in time. It's not because of lighting or something, but we had more and more sets, and they wanted to put more scenes into the movie. So they are writing new scenes during the shooting. I thought that the budget of the lighting was massive, but we had, budget-wise, we had bigger project like this one. This was your question? Yeah. Okay.
We had a lot of overtime, though, actually.
Yeah.
I remember that.
So usually we, the shooting day, we had 5 days of week to shoot, plus we had one or two pre-light days during the weekends.
It was 6 days, every week 6 days, pretty much. And Saturday was a bit easier, but 6 days for, I can't remember so
usually
so long.
Usually 16 hours of every day to work, so we could forget our families and friends, and we went home only to sleep. But I think that was our only way how we can help Roger and Denis works. My crew always came earlier to the studio, when Denis and Roger step into the set, we always waited for them with lights, so all the lights were set up, they could see what do we have for today in the set, and you know, that was a good starting point. If they want to change something, then right away we can react for that, we can spare some time for them. And always at the end of the day, we always stood there a bit longer. If they wanted to change something for the next day, we did it during the evening. And I think that was the greatest thing that, you know, they were so, both of them actually, Roger and Denis, was so motivating person that, you know, they gave us so many inputs or you know, motivation that all of my crew that wanted to leave for the movie, actually. So we wanted to do the great movie for Roger. I hope that this is gonna be the one for him. Yeah.
Great, more questions? What do you want to talk about what we have in this scene? We have just a few more minutes.
No, just as for the future of lighting, I pretty much share Christian's opinion that LED technology is growing stronger, and we can use LED walls for lighting, and sky panels going to be more and more featureful. They can put more features in it while you are using, so expanding the usage is really good. Yeah, I think video and lighting will fusion closer and closer, so it's going to merge into one, hopefully. We will see.
Great. Well, I think we're at our time, just short of it, but thank you very much.
Thank you.